Right, Aki Kareem for BBTV. I am delighted to be joined by Miss GB herself, Natasha Jonas. Natasha, great to see you. And I understand you're doing some homeschooling at the minute and it's going very well.
Yeah. Listen, I was stressed. Now I know how Ofsted feels for teachers because I was pushed to my pressure point here. And but yeah, she performed well and she did well. And yeah, I'm happy with myself now.
Well, I am a teacher and I've had two Ofsteds, so I know how you're feeling, and it's nice to know that you know how we're feeling as well. does she like boxing as well, though? Do you sort of get her involved with that, or do you sort of try and keep her away from it? What's your views on that?
No, I mean, my parents just encourage me to be active, so that's the same that I'll do for her. The sport will find you and you'll find a sport for you. But yeah, she comes along to Joe's. Obviously, schools are not in at the minute. So she comes along, you know, she thinks she's second to Joe's second. She gives me drinks in between rounds. I'm chasing her down the track. You know, she has a little punch on the back. She's not really too fussed about me, to be honest. She'd rather be like her Auntie Keita.
Well, it's good to, I mean, I saw actually on your Instagram a while ago that you, some of the work you were doing with the Joe Gallagher Academy, I saw some young ladies coming through, and it's probably great for them to speak to you. You know, do you actively try and encourage young ladies and young girls to get involved with the sport then?
Yeah, I think sport instills so many things, not just boxing. When I go to schools, like, I am a boxer, that's the sport I found, but I tried about 1,000 before that. So, you know, there's loads of like life skills that I think sport instills. It's not just the skill of the sport itself. I just happen to be good at that. You know, I'm disciplined. I work hard. I can target myself. You know, I can work as part of a team. I've got good communication skills. I can work on my own. You know, all these things. If you asked an employer, what would your ideal employer be? He'd say some of them. And that's what I think, you know, sport does. There's so much bigger things than just the skill itself. So, you know, being, and people don't realize how social sports are now that gyms are shutting everyone's like, oh, I haven't seen this one, I haven't seen that one, because you don't realize how social the social aspect of it.
Yeah, no, that's definitely a great point, and I hope the politicians are listening as well when to that statement. Well, the dust has firmly settled on your last performance, which was a brilliant performance, but I know it was recently voted. This is obviously the fight with Terry Harper. It was recently voted as female fight of the year. And I think round 5 was voted as female round of the year, even though I actually thought round 8 was better. But
Bardy for me.
Is that any consolation, or are you still a little bit, you know, is it a bit too little too late for you?
I do, you know what? I'm over it. It is what it was. Like, I can't keep judging myself off it. No result's going to change no matter how I feel about it, and to be fair, it's not Terry's fault either. So yeah, it's nice, and obviously the Ring magazine's a prestigious magazine, and you know, to even be up in the nominees, never mind even winning, that's nice. It's nice to have, and it's nice to, you know, show the grandkids one day, but you know, it doesn't make any difference. I didn't win and I wanted to.
Fair enough. And as you mentioned, yeah, as you say, you know, the decisions aren't the boxer's fault. You know, you and Terry both gave absolutely everything. It was a brilliant spectacle. Given the performance you put in yourself, given the fact that you proved a lot of people wrong, given what you did in the fight, is it a little bit frustrating that it perhaps the momentum didn't tide over into something, something big, and, you know, a resolution by now into something bigger?
Yeah, a little bit. And to be fair, that wasn't the best me either. I still think I had a lot more to give, and I would do given a rematch, prove that. But, you know, I think people, because of the loss to Obanoff and because Teddy had won, had judged me off that, and said, you know, I was too old, I was too this, I was too that, I'd never done 10 rounds, not fit enough on all this. And I was just happy to prove them people wrong. And hats off to them. A lot of them messaged me after the fight saying, look, we're sorry we did that, we wrote you off, we get it. But I'd gone through and say, and liked all of them on social media, because I thought, right, when this fight's over, I'm going to come back and reply to all of them. But obviously with them doing that, I didn't need to. But yeah, it, you know, it is what it is.
Well, I think after the Obinar fight, a lot of people did think that might be towards the end for you. But then you roll back the years and you put on this brilliant performance. I mean, what was it about that camp that allowed you to do that? I mean, I'm not trying to just make it all specifically about this fight, but there was something that you seemed a bit different in that camp. There was an aura about yourself and even about Joe going into that camp and into the bubble.
Yeah, we were so confident because, like, obviously when you see it on telly, you're seeing the end product, but we've worked through a camp, you know, 10 to 12 weeks, and you see the developments and you see, and I think for me personally and a little bit with Joe, because people were saying that I couldn't do it, that was like giving me a different type of motivation. Obviously, we'd had a lockdown before that as well. And in the lockdown, I went away and worked on myself mentally. Physically, your body can do anything, but your mind has to be with it. So I went away and worked on myself. And me and Joe were like, you know, even with the young kids in Joe's academy, we was discussing books and the best ones to read and what makes you tick and all things like that. And I was just learning about myself. And you don't always get that time to do that. The baby was heavily involved in the camp like she is now. Like, you know, and it just gives you that little bit of extra motivation that she was there watching spars, giving me, you know, drinks in between rounds. And I was like, you know, it probably won't happen ever again. But it was nice to have that time with her, and she can see what happens when she goes to school and mummy goes to work, and she can see that. That was, obviously you want to win the belt anyway, but that was a major reason of why I wanted to bring the belt home to it as well, because that was the, you know, this is what we went through and this is the product of it. This is what you get for it. You know, this is the reward. So I was more than gutted not to do that. But, you know, I think all them things just added up, and that's what it was. And, you know, the more you tell me I can't do something, the more I'm going to prove you wrong.
Yeah, I suppose it's that fighter spirit you've got there. And I think the fight left people wanting to see you out against, you know, sooner. I mean, have there been any developments? Is there anything on the horizon for you at the minute? What's the current situation?
There isn't any offer or anything as it stands right now. But hopefully we can come to something. We, I'm talking NTK and myself, I've been in contact with Matchroom. You know, there's lots of people and fighters in my weight division and the ones above that, you know, anyone between 130 and 140, I can fight. I'll happily fight, especially if it's for a belt. So yeah, we're just trying to come to terms with something for that. And yeah, hopefully something comes off.
Probably seen this already, but there's been quite a few Instagrams and social media accounts that are talking up a fight between yourself, a rematch between yourself and Katie Taylor, a professional rematch. Now, that is obviously a fight that would sell really well in the UK and Ireland, and it's a fight that, given your last performance, people wouldn't be writing you off like they were last time in, because they know you can sort of pull out these sort of performances. Now, how realistic do you think that is? And if so, would that be the sort of fight you would want to really get you locked back into that mentality again?
No, I said as soon as the Harper fight was finished, I don't want to go back now, because I've proved I'm at that level. I want to stay at that level, and I want a title. So, I mean, like I said, MTK are doing the best to get me out there and to home in on one of the champions. Terry's made it perfectly clear that, like, I'm not the route she's going to take, even though there was a lot of promises after the fight. So that's kind of gone, and I can't just keep waiting around for Terry Harper either. So, you know, I'll either put myself in a mandatory position where she has to fight me, or I'll just go somewhere else. And that's what we're working on. We're working on other plans to get me to other belts or other routes. And just to go back to your first point, you know, the whole Katie Taylor thing, that's been said since I turned pro, and that was kind of the whole build-up of you win, we'll fight and have the rematch at the end. So is it likely? Fingers crossed, hopefully. That's what I want. That's, you know, I think it's a like you say, a good fight. I do think, you know, Taylor's a different class to Teddy. So again, you have to be better than you was before and better than you've ever been before. Obviously, she did beat me in the Olympics, and that's something, it got to me. So yeah, it's definitely something that I want. Definitely something that can happen. And yeah, I fingers crossed it does. And yeah, to be fair, social media tells me who I'm fighting and when I'm fighting or who's my opponents before I even know half the time.
It's mad, isn't it? The social media. And I think that social media has had an even bigger role in boxing during lockdown. It seems that, you know, everyone seems to know what's going on before fighters do, don't they? You said in one interview that I watched of yours, you actually said one slip up and you kind of tossed aside. That's something that a lot of boxers go through, or they feel like they go through. And do you feel that's something that needs to be sort of looked at? Because like yourself, you lost the Ovanov fight, you come back storming with a storming performance, and it's happened so many times over the years. I mean, if you go back a few generations, and a loss didn't mean anything really, it was nothing. Do you think, you know, promoters and fans need to be a bit more accepting of a loss and get a bit more behind the fighters when that does happen?
I mean, I think acceptance is the wrong word. You're an athlete and you're two versus another person. No one wants to lose. But the actual reality of it is that how many people come out with a record like Mayweather or Calzaghe? Not many. How many boxers? Not many. So, you know, protecting that, oh, well, you've got it. It feels like everything and it's the world. And then once it's gone, like, I don't want to say a relief because that's the wrong word as well, but there is so much pressure to carry that. And then there's so many boxes that are there just ready for you to slip up to take your place, and you do get left to the bottom of the pile. So it can be tough, and it isn't about accepting for fans, and because, you know, promoters are there to promote you, and they're going to promote the people that wins. It's a business to them. That's not, we're kind of doing the sport, but to them that's their business, and you obviously are going to go with the ones that winning and making you. So I don't kind of blame the business in that sense, because it does make sense to do that. But, you know, fans are so fickle, you know. One day they're cheering you, next day they're booing you. It's just you just got to take it as an athlete. You just take it on the chin. There's nothing you can do. There's nothing you can say. And should it be changed? Probably, but will it? Probably not. So,
well, I've noticed that obviously, you know, your camp is still a camp where there's lots of massive fights left for a lot of the fighters in there. Have you sort of, as you've got a little bit into more of your mature years, let's say, have you found different ways to train? See how I did that? Yeah. have you found different ways to train? And, you know, because I remember speaking to Martin Murray about this, and he said as he got a little bit older, he found ways to train smarter, you know, maybe the same intensity, but just shorter. And there were different ways he looked at. Have you found the same thing as well?
No, 100%. The thing about experience is that you find what works for you. And I don't need to be the same boxer that I was when I started as a pro or when I started as an amateur, because I've moved on from them. I've developed the skills I know that I have now that I definitely didn't have then. So that adapts into your boxing style. You know, there's certain things that you're always going to improve and work on, because that's just the nature of the sport. You have to learn, you have to get better. And especially if you're moving up in caliber of opponents, so you have to get better. But yeah, I think smarter is the right way. You just train smarter. You don't need to do them things that you did years ago, because you're actually more experienced and better off not doing them now. And you know that now. So yeah, you just become clever about it.
Yeah, fair point. And, you know, just going back to your stable now, obviously Callum had just come off an attempt to beat Canelo Alvarez. We know how good Canelo was, thought it was a good effort. You know, you've got people like Lee and people like Callum Dunton who are looking, who are on the verge, really, or should be on the verge of something big. So there's that feel in the camp still. Is that kind of good to be around that, around other fighters who are, you know, on the verge of getting something, you know, big as well?
Yeah, it's the best feeling in the world, because when everyone's got a date, everyone will push and drag each other through the sessions. So like you might be a little bit tired, and then someone's like, come on, we've got one more round, and so you'll do it. And if you was on your own, or they wasn't there, or they didn't have a date and they wasn't do that, you might not do it. So it's good to be around that, like, you know, and because everyone's an athlete anyway, everyone's naturally competitive. So, you know, if Paul gets a certain distance on the VersaClimber, you best believe I'm there trying to get the same one. If, you know, Jose's doing something on the bike, you best believe that Callum Johnson's going to try and beat it. And that's just the way it is. That's just the nature of you as an athlete. But it's good to be around that, because obviously the better you are, the more output you get, and the better you're going to be eventually anyway, and the more fitter you'll get a lot quicker. So it is always good to be around that. And I'm so used to being around that. I'm not one of them people. I don't think that, you know, every fight is different, but I couldn't go into a gym with just me and the coach and train like that. I like to bounce off people. I like the interaction, like I said, the social side of it. Even though when I'm there, it's all about me, and it's, you know, I'm doing my workout, it's still nice to have that, like, company.
Yeah. Well, that's been one of the features of the Gallagher's gym over the years, that it's been a real unit. I remember actually commentating on one of your fights at Oldham Leisure Centre.
Yeah,
it was a cold night, and it was, you know, there weren't many people in there, but your whole gym turned up. And I thought, you know what, that's got to say something. You have always had that that kind of close bond in the gym, haven't you? Or the gymnasium, yeah, I call it.
Yeah, the camaraderie, there's a big word for you. But yeah, that's just a lot of the lads as well. Like, I've obviously the Smiths, you know, I've come through the rotunda and everything with them. It feels like I follow them sometimes, but that's just the way we are. I've always known Crawler, you know, everyone in the whole sport loves Crawler. Me and Ophie had Jose Burton, we had the same sponsors, so I've always knew Ophie. It was only really Marcus and Sam that I didn't. It was like a group of people. And, you know, when you're sometimes when you're female going into, like, you know, a different setup, it's a bit awful. But because of where I'd come from, like the GP setup, and obviously knowing them a long time, I didn't have that. So that was kind of like, yeah, it's Tasha, let's go. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't like an awkward thing of like, you've got to prove yourself or anything in the gym. It's just get in and get involved and get stuck in and do the work.
Yeah, it does show as well. And, you know, just thinking today, I actually watched some of your fights back this morning, just because I knew I was interviewing you today, and I was thinking, you know, I've had a long career, but you know, you're still at the business end. There's still a lot of big nights left for you. There's also, since your career has been going on, there's been lots of other of the ladies really reaching the tops. So people like Savannah Marshall, Chantel Cameron, who have won world titles, and I know you've known them for a long time, and you've got Rachel Ball and Shannon Courtney coming up for a world title fight as well. And have you sort of been impressed with the levels that the game has gone on from the female side? And are you sort of impressed with the British and Irish world champions as well, the current crop?
Yeah, I mean, Katie's always been someone from amateurs that, you know, has always stood out. A record speaks for itself, really. But it was great to see other females come behind that, and especially, you know, everyone's got a story. And in, like, the greatest respect to us, we always knew how good women's boxing was. We just needed the world to see it. So, you know, the big promoters getting behind it, the big media outlets getting behind it and putting it on them big stages has opened that up to the world, and it's been received greatly. Obviously, the fights, we haven't got the big, the depth in the game that the men have at the minute. But, you know, when 2016, when 2020s or 2021's crop turns, and, you know, 2024, 2023, but that's going to come, because now females have got that option of, like, you have got the option of whether you want to stay amateur or go pro. And that wasn't really an option before that. So we are going to get that depth. And the great thing, because of there being not that the same amount of depth, is that it's a bit harder to avoid the best. And everyone wants to be the best. Everyone wants to do what Clarissa Shields has done and what Katie Taylor's done and be the undisputed, because it's not impossible to do that. Sometimes with the men, people will go, you know, one belt way, and the other one will go in a different way, and they never always meet, or they meet and they could have met a lot sooner, or one's bit past it. With the females, everyone wants to fight each other, and everyone wants to fight each other right now. And that's great for our sport, because now people want to see it. People want to see how you develop. People are accepting of that. Yeah, right. These are the two best, and these have been built up. Now we want to see them fight, and that's what it needs. You know, we had that with, you know, Ben Collins and Eubank, and that kind of homegrown British like rivalry. Groves and De Gale, you know, Callum and Rocky. They're the kind of things that help you grow as a, you know, brand of yourself, but also for the sport, because people have got, yeah, we've got two of the best at the best, and the fact that we're all British is even better.
Yeah, you can't beat you cannot beat a good domestic dust up. Just love those nights. You've also dipped your toe into the punditry work as well, and getting on the big screen, doing the punditry work and doing the analysis. That's it. And you know, you've come across very well doing that. Is that something that you would like? And obviously, Crawler done a lot of that from your gym as well. Would you perhaps see a career after boxing in that, or would you prefer going and being like a mentor within the boxing gyms, or you know, what's your plan for when the career is done and dusted?
To be fair, I think boxing takes up so much of your life that it's going to be a hard void to fill when it goes. I've already kind of experienced that when I left the amateurs, because that was for me the end of boxing, as I thought it then. And I did go back to coaching, and it was good to do the other side and still be involved in the sport. And I've always, you know, kept links with local schools and youth provisions, because I do think it's important if you've got like a platform to be positive and to encourage people and, you know, engage with people. That, like, so I'll always do that. But the punditry way, you know, to sit back and just kind of commentate on what you know and slag other people's performances off instead of your own is always a good thing. You know, you get the best seats in the house. You're it's talking about what you know. So it's quite comfortable. It's good to do. And it's definitely something that I would like to do more often. And yeah, fingers crossed I can get a Fiori Joshua.
Oh,
I can get on one of, if that happens, I can get on one of the teams for that. So yeah, it is great to do. I find it it's a bit nervous at the start, but then once you get into it, you are just speaking about what you know, so it's not that bad.
And you're actually quite an honest pundit as well. And you know, how honest do you think a pundit should be? And also, when you're watching your own fights back, and you're listening to the commentary and that night I commentated on you was fine because you actually blitzed her. So it was all good stuff. But, you know, sometimes when you listen back and you listen to commentary and you listen to the way people speak about you, how does that play into your own mind? And do you factor that in when you're, doing the punditry?
Good question. I try and be as honest as I can, because I think, you know, if you're a hardcore boxing fan, you'll know and if I say something that's just, you know, leaning to one person or one side, it's like it kind of takes away from the value of what I'm adding to what I'm saying. And if you know about boxing, then I'm not being true to myself, because I'm just trying to be like cheering one, like, yeah, being a cheerleader kind of thing, when that's not what I'm about. I'm trying to be just honest and be truthful to the everyday fan and say what I see, you know, whether that's someone winning or losing or, you know, doing stuff wrong or not, I'll just say what I see. I forgot the other part of the question. What did you say?
Yeah, I was just saying that, you know, when you actually watch back yourself, your fights yourself, and, you know, or things about you, and you're looking at what other pundits have said and other said, how do you sort of approach that? Do you sort of bear a little grudge at the back of your mind, or do you just sort of let it wash over you?
To be fair, sometimes if I think that punditry is being a bit biased, I'll switch the sound off. and I'll judge you for myself. So I do keep that in mind when I'm boxing and people are thinking. I do listen and take on board what they're saying. I also listened to interviews before, and I remember we laugh about it now, but it was Macklin had said, Tasha's gonna do this, Tasha's gonna do that. And so when I was working with Sky, I was like, he was saying about Povetkin, and he was saying, he's old, he's experienced. I was like, he wasn't saying that with me and Harper, he was just saying I was old. So we had to laugh about it, but so there's things that I remember and I think, okay, I'm going to come back to you. You know that's going to come and bite you. But I do listen to the to commentary on my fight, and I do take it on board if I think that it's right or if I think that it's relevant.
Yeah, you're not shy, are you? Basically, you do give as good as you would get, so to speak, in that sense. But I think you're a welcome addition to the punditry side of things, because it gives a good insight into not just the female game, but it gives an insight into what you think personally. And it's great to have a lot of different fighters giving their opinions. I've really enjoyed speaking to you today and just finding out a little bit more about where you're at the minute. It does sound like you're still as hungry as you sort of were at the beginning of your pro career.
Yeah, do you know what? I don't want to say I feel like I've been a little bit wronged, but I do. So that's also given me another drive. And I am back in the gym and I'm training. And I honestly, as much as I want to date, I would never wish a failed COVID test on anybody. But I will be training alongside all these camps like I'm fighting, because if anyone does, I'll be there to step in the place. And it's sad, but that's the times that we're in. You've seen a lot of it happen with other fighters on other cards, and when you get that opportunity, you have to take it and you have to run with it. So I would encourage anyone, small hall boxers who's not signed with Matchroom or any other of the big promotions, keep yourself ready, because you can get the call. And that's just what I'm doing.
I think that's really, really great advice. And there's been some good stories, hasn't there, over the lockdown, of people who've taken that at short notice and got in there. And Natasha, I really appreciate your time. We've done well, because neither of our daughters have burst in.
I know. I had the door twitching really before.
So maybe we should cut our whilst we're ahead. And I really appreciate your time. I hope we can do this again sometime. And in the meantime, thanks so much. Is there anything you want to say to just the people that have supported you all the way through and everything like that?
Just thank you. And again, thanks to yourself and all the positive things that you say, and promote about women's boxing and in women in boxing. It's really important that we get that message across, especially to the young amateurs now, that, it's a bit of a worrying time. They don't know when they're going to fight next. They don't know when they're next in the gym. And some of them are struggling and don't know what to be doing. So, let's keep it positive. Let's keep it together. And let's get through this all together. So, thanks.
Tasha, it's been an absolute pleasure. Take care. Enjoy the rest of your evening. And
you.
See you again soon.
See you soon.